Tim is the senior lecturer in military history at the University of Kent, an author of a wonderful book called The Irish Regiments in the Great War, with its subtitle Discipline and Morale, which shows you how he addresses those two really important topics. And we look forward to his forthcoming book being written with Ian Beckett and Mark Connolly on the British Army and the First World War. So, ladies and gentlemen, Tim Bowman.
Well, thanks very much, John, for that very kind introduction. What I've been asked to talk to you about today is the Gallipoli campaign and British strategy. And this gentleman here was preempting me before lunch. I suppose there's a couple of things to say by way of introduction, and then we'll see how well my PowerPoint slides work. I suppose in retrospect, as you've heard already today, the Gallipoli campaign seems to have been a fairly crazy scheme to modernise. It seems in some ways inexplicable, and it's actually studied a number of military academies in the world, including the British Joint Service Command Staff College, as an example of what not to do in terms of planning a campaign and planning combined operations. So you then sort of wonder, why do contemporaries, does this look like a good idea at all? We also know in retrospect that the Ottoman war effort lasted almost as long as the German war effort itself, right up to October 1918. So the idea that the Ottoman Empire was right for the picking and with one push would fall over also is highly unlikely, it seems, in retrospect, but to contemporaries did seem to be the case. Now, I suppose contemporaries in some ways are motivated by what Winston Churchill talks about. He says that there must be a better way of prosecuting the war than sending troops to chew barbed wire and France and Flanders. And I think it's hard to disagree with that statement from Churchill, that there was a desire to try and do something else. Now, Churchill, of course, we remember as a very inspired military leader in the Second World War, particularly in the dark days of 1940 and 1941, when he takes over the premiership, and for restraining the Americans from launching the D-Day invasion in, incredibly, 1942. Some Americans actually thought that they could go into Western Europe with a good chance of success at that point. But Churchill himself wasn't a brilliant strategist, and that's something that's shown very markedly by the Gallipoli campaign. In the Second World War, he of course has two chiefs of the Imperial General Staff, both Ulstermen, who are able to restrain him to some degree, but you'll say a bit about what working with them is like. First one's Field Marshal Sir John Dill from Lurgan, who is Chief of the Imperial General Staff 1940-41, and finds working with Churchill then incredibly difficult. He says that what Churchill repeatedly wants is for rabbits to be pulled out of empty hats. That basically the British Army isn't in a position to do anything, but Churchill still comes up with all these schemes that he wants to be prosecuted, and ultimately that relationship breaks down.
Just to let you know what's happening, ladies and gentlemen, there's been a power cut in the building at the minute, which we're working on. So we're okay for the minute. We haven't been asked to evacuate. I think we've opened the doors, but it's getting a bit stuffy in here. If you hear alarms going off, don't worry. If it's a real alarm, we will let you know. So we'll carry on. And you're missing Tim. You're missing Tim's wonderful graphics. But I'm sorry.
Hopefully come back to the maps and so on. Dill's successor then is Field Marshal Sir Alan Brooke, later Lord Alan Brooke, one of the Brookes of County Fermanagh. And Churchill himself talks about what it's like working with Brooke. And he says, what happens when I shout at this man and bang the table? He bangs the table harder and shouts at me louder. And it really takes that sort of relationship for Churchill's ideas to be made productive. What Alan Brooke also says is that Churchill has five military ideas a day during the Second World War. One of them's good, but Churchill doesn't know which one that is. So you do actually need that sort of military direction to make sense of that. And unfortunately, what we get at the Gallipoli campaign is what's often talked about as amateur strategy, and that a lot of the military professional elements that managed to channel this into something productive in the Second World War simply aren't there. I minus my maps here, but I'll talk briefly about what else was hoped about in the Gallipoli campaign. The idea of Gallipoli essentially is that the British fleet will manage to get through the Dardanelles Straits, will bombard Constantinople, the Ottoman capital, and the Ottomans will surrender. So that's the sort of basic bit that knocks the Ottoman Empire out of the war. But there's more than that also. There's the idea that all the Balkan powers can be brought in against the Turks. And of course, from 1911 up to 1913, you'd had two Balkan wars. And basically what had happened is the Ottoman Empire had been pushed out of its European possessions, and those taken over by Bulgaria, Serbia and Greece. Now, a lot of British statesmen, particularly David Lloyd George, were really thinking about how that Balkan League could be put back together and how it could be turned, firstly, against the Ottoman Empire, this idea that a Greek army could be landed at Gallipoli is there until quite late in the day, but also then how it could be used against the Austro-Hungarian Empire. So the idea of Gallipoli is not only do they knock the Ottoman Empire out of the war, but the Austro-Hungarian Empire out of the war. Now, the problem with that is that there's just endless wishful thinking. That the Balkan powers had united in the First Balkan War to get the Ottomans out of Europe. They then fought amongst each other in the Second Balkan War, and it was a moot point whether Bulgarians, Greeks and Serbs hated each other more than they hated the Turks at the outbreak of the First World War. So that idea of the Balkan League, you know, looked attractive but wasn't really going anywhere. The other aspect to that, of course, is the idea that the Ottoman army had performed very poorly in the First Balkan War, done slightly better in the Second, but ultimately this idea of the Ottoman Empire as the sick man of Europe, of a declining power, declining military power, was very much there, and that shaped a lot of the strategic thinking. Another reason for a Gallipoli campaign, or some campaign beyond the Western Front, is the concern by many British politicians and senior military figures that the British war effort was simply subordinate to the French, that with the Western Front dominating, all the British units were really becoming was cores of the French army. So opening up the front at Gallipoli meant that there was a sort of independent British strategy, but also it would be a naval-led strategy. That was another key element to it, the idea that the Navy was being rather neglected in what it was being asked to do in terms of patrolling the North Sea, and that it could actually be used to full effect against the Turks. And of course the British Navy at this stage, not only the largest Navy in the world, but still based on the two power standards, the idea it was larger than the next two biggest armies in the world, the German and American. So that's the sort of, you know, military muscle that Britain wanted to flex, and obviously it wasn't able to do that on the Western Front. The military assets that the British government has at its disposal by the start of 1915 also in some ways shaped the idea for a Gallipoli campaign. As we heard earlier from Keith, the Kitchener armies had come together in August and September 1914, but are still very poorly trained as you go into early 1915. They can't be used against the Germans on the Western Front. They're not well enough trained for that. But the Turks, an army that had been defeated fairly easily before, partially trained troops against them would probably be fine. So that's one element to it. The other is the nature of the ships, which I'm conscious Tom's going to say more about. But basically the Royal Navy has on its hands a lot of what are called pre-dreadnought battleships. Battleships that have been built before 1905 and that aren't seen to be fit to take on the German high seas fleet, but are still pretty well armoured and have very large 15-16 inch guns, so an idea that they can then be used against the Ottoman Empire in a way that they couldn't really be used anywhere much else. And we'll hear a lot more about those later on, the problems of using those ships. If we turn then to, that's sort of by way of a few introductory comments, if we turn to what British military planning is like before the First World War, it's worth saying that Britain really wasn't committed to anything very firmly before 1914. There were the ententes with Russia and with France. There had been military conversations with the French, but it was still unclear what exactly Britain was going to do on the outbreak of war. And the British Expeditionary Force had been organised as 6 infantry and 1 cavalry divisions in 1908 as part of the Hull reforms. But concerns and thoughts about where they would be deployed, even on the outbreak of war, there's confusion about whether they'd be used in Belgium, in France, or with the Navy to raid North German ports. So, you know, we think of these Entente military conversations, they're not treaties. The British Army, British Navy, wasn't actually committed to any particular course of action, which then means that, you know, Gallipoli can come out of that as an alternative to the Western Front fairly easily. The British General Staff itself had been organised in 1904, 1905, on into 1906 really, modelled very much on the German General Staff. And actually the idea for the General Staff, or the Secretary of State for War when it was put together rather, was H.O. Arnold Foster, who was MP for that notoriously conservative constituency of West Belfast, of all places, held his seat with 52 votes in his last election. And he was quite a military thinker, and this idea was that the German army was the best in Europe, so you really wanted to try and model your own army on that. Now, the problem with the General Staff in Britain, as John's alluded to, is that there weren't actually that many men that had gone through the staff college, so those that were trained for the higher direction of war, for policy making and so on, there weren't that many of them. Too many of the officers that did pass through the staff college simply returned to regimental duty or did what were basically admin jobs. They're not sitting there planning out, you know, endless contingency plans and looking at intelligence reports and intelligence surveys. And promotion in the British Army wasn't actually linked to holding the position of past staff college. It's more down to that old British tradition of Buggin's turn, that seniority basically shaped promotion. So Sir John French, who leads the original British Expeditionary Force, hadn't gone through the staff college, wasn't past staff college, and that's quite a good example of how you could get to the top without that accolade. When the General Staff was put together, a key element within it, one of the so-called directorates within it, was the Directorate of Military Operations. And this, again, as John's alluded to, carried out some contingency planning, as did the Committee of Imperial Defence, which was composed of a mixture of soldiers, sailors and politicians, but not in great detail. There's not a whole raft of these different plans you can look at. Ironically, there was this General Staff exercise in 1906 which suggested that you could force the Dardanelles, perhaps if you were very lucky, if you caught the Turks napping and if you had about 60,000 troops as a bare minimum to play with. Ultimately what it said was that this was going to be very risky and shouldn't be done. It went on to say that the great problem with trying to do anything against the Turks at the Dardanelles was that the build-up of troops in the Eastern Mediterranean would clearly come to the attention of the Turks, who would then obviously work out what was going to happen and reinforce their forts on the Dardanelles. Now, that report is carefully filed away in 1906. The findings are presented to the War Cabinet by Major General Charles Colwell, who's the Director of Military Operations, his father from Ballycastle, good local link for us there. But Colwell tells the War Cabinet that 60,000 troops will probably be able to manage this operation, and that really the best idea is to leave it to the commander on the ground to come up with the plans. So when the Directorate of Military Operations is set up in 1905-6, one of the ideas is it's meant to be there to devise war planning, troop strengths, how you balance things between the Army and the Navy. What Colwell basically says in 1915 is, well, hand it to Ian Hamilton, good luck with them, which isn't really what the Directorate of Military Operations is meant to do. Particularly bizarre given that Colwell, who's famous for a book called Small Wars, which is basically the first British doctrine, if there is such a thing, on counterinsurgency. He actually writes a book on amphibious warfare as well, so very strange that he doesn't provide something more thoughtful than leaving the commander on the ground. The General Staff system itself then effectively breaks down on the outbreak of war. Most members of the General Staff went off to join their regiments or to take up staff posts with the British Expeditionary Force in France, and the Staff College itself closed. So this sort of professional guidance for politicians largely disappears. I'll come back to this a little more later on in the talk. And another aspect we see pre-war is very poor relations between the Army and the Navy, or rather between the War Office and the Admiralty. Remember that you didn't have a combined Ministry of Defence at this stage. It was still a Ministry for the Army, the War Office, a Ministry for the Navy, the Admiralty. And they are involved in infighting over budgets, amongst much else. So basically what the Navy says is that, well, you know, any attempt to invade the British Isles will be defeated by the Royal Navy. The Army just doesn't have to bother about this, which, you know, isn't what the Army want to hear, because one of the reasons you get the Hull reforms and the territorial force set up is the idea that you need about 14, 15 British divisions for the defence of the UK. So that there's bad relations there. I think there's only one very small exercise carried out with a brigade in East Anglia in about 1911, which is actually a combined operation between the Navy and the Army, and has soldiers being rowed ashore. But what they're being rowed ashore in are simply lifeboats. These are not any sort of specialised landing craft, so there's no real thought given to that at all. What we see as you go into late 1914, early 1915, is some sort of division within British policy making between two groups that can very loosely be described as Easterners and Westerners. Easterners who are looking for some military campaign that can be opened up somewhere away from the Western Front that offers a chance of success. Westerners who believe that every man and every round has to be sent to France. It's wrong to see that group as a particularly cohesive one, but you'll be familiar with a number of the names that are involved. Churchill, I've already alluded to, First Lord of the Admiralty, so very much looking for something else that the Admiralty could do in the war. David Lloyd George, the Chancellor of the Exchequer, again a very sort of restless mind, future Prime Minister. Sir Maurice Hankey, who was a retired Royal Marines colonel and secretary to the cabinet, who quite fancied himself as a strategist and actually wasn't too bad at it when he was given his head. And then there's Admiral Sir Jackie Fisher, one of the most senior admirals, who wanted to do something with the Royal Navy. His preferred option was to recapture Heligoland, which had been given to the Germans in the 1880s, just off the north coast of Germany, that would allow British forces to bottle up the Germans in Kiel. But if he couldn't do that, he seemed quite keen on Gallipoli, at least at the start. So you know, there's a number of names there, some you'll be familiar with, who can be loosely identified as Easterners, but they're not a particularly cohesive group and in some cases fall out with each other. If we're thinking then of what this sort of Eastern promise is, parts of this I've already touched on slightly, there is the idea of the complete surrender of the Ottoman Empire, with battleships bombarding Constantinople, the idea that that would lead to a revolution. Indeed, Charles Caldwell thought that even the presence of British ships at the Dardanelles would be enough to lead to a revolution in the Ottoman Empire and for them to sue for peace. Tied to that is, of course, the concern that if something wasn't done against the Ottomans, they would try to invade Egypt and would try to capture the Suez Canal, as indeed they do try to do in early 1915. So there were sort of reasonable strategic ideas there. Another idea is, of course, to open up the Black Sea route to Russia, partly to supply Russia with military materials, but also to get grain exports going again from Russia to France and Britain, which were already starting to see problems due to logistical lift, and were to see more problems as the U-boat campaign started to intensify. With the collapse of the Ottoman Empire, there was then this idea the Balkan powers would come in, and indeed an idea that Italy would come into the war, and that the whole lot would be wrapped up very quickly. The idea that's put together by David Lloyd George, Chancellor Exchequer, is that Germany is being propped up during the war by the Ottoman Empire and by Austro-Hungary. So in a memorable phrase, he talks about kicking the pit props out from under Germany. The problem with that, of course, is it's pretty obvious as the war goes on, and particularly from Alex Watson's book, Ring of Steel, that actually the Germans underpin the Austro-Hungarian and the Ottoman war effort, not the other way around. So actually even knocking the Ottomans out of the war, knocking the Austro-Hungarians out, didn't necessarily mean that Germany was going to be defeated. But again, retrospect is a great general. If we think then about what these sort of conditions were for amateur strategy, John Gooch, in particular, has been very scathing about the planning that went into the Gallipoli campaign and feels that it lacked any really proper professional military input. And there's a number of reasons we can look to for that. The first one, really, is that very strange decision in some ways to appoint Lord Kitchener as Secretary of State for War in August 1914. I think it's Margot Asquith, the Prime Minister's wife, who says that Kitchener is a great poster, but not a great man. And that rather shows us some of the problems with Kitchener. Now, in some ways, Kitchener brings a lot of strategic sense to the War Office. Kitchener is the man who says that the war will last for at least 3 years, and that Britain must be able to field 70 divisions. That's quite prescient when everybody else is talking about a short war and a war that may be over by Christmas. But Kitchener doesn't really understand the position he's in, which is the real problem, that he should be there as a civilian Secretary of State for War, but he is there as the most senior Field Marshal on the active list and keeps turning up to the office wearing his Field Marshal's uniform. So the problem with all that is that Hamilton, as theatre commander, doesn't think to say, calm down, Minister, you know, I'm the military professional here, you know, this is what I think is going to happen. The view is, you know, the boss has spoken, that Kitchener, as Field Marshal, has looked at all this, must know what he's doing militarily, and it's not really up to anybody else in the military to question that, and that then leads to enormous problems. Kitchener, of course, is brought in partly for an Irish reason, again, this sort of Curra incident that had happened in March 1914 had seen J.B. Seeley forced to resign for making promises to army officers that they wouldn't have to act against the Ulster Volunteer Force. In the period between March 14 and the outbreak of war, Asquith then, as Prime Minister, is also Secretary of State for War. And on the outbreak of war, there's discussion about who they should have. Very briefly, literally for a few days, they bring back R.B. Haldane, who had introduced the famous military reforms in 1806 and 1808. But Haldane had said some rather unfortunate things about his admiration for German philosophy. And that would seem to be good enough reason to get rid of him. But it is one of those great what-ifs that if Haldane had come back as a civilian Secretary of State for War, how some of the military figures might then have responded to the Gallipoli planning. The dispersal of the general staff in the outbreak of war, I've mentioned that already. But this meant that many very able soldiers, men like Henry Wilson, that Keith Jeffery's written about, Neville Macready, the Adjutant General, end up going overseas with the original British Expeditionary Force. Staff College was closed down. Most officers who were staff qualified went back to battalion commands or to be things like brigade majors with the Expeditionary Force. And a number were killed very early on in the war, Brigadier General John Gough, Haig's Chief of Staff, being a good example. So that dispersal of the general staff at the outbreak of war is enormously damaging. So Henry Wilson, who had been the Director of Military Operations and had put all the planning together for mobilisation, is packed off to France as basically the Deputy Chief of Staff, and one could argue it would be better if he had stayed as Director of Military Operations. I think my maps have come back here, so I can sort of run through these if I can find my control. So basically this is the Balkans in 1911, as you can see, so you can see just how much there is of the Ottoman Empire in Europe at that point. So that's our first slide. The end of the First Balkan War, you can see that there's very little of the Ottoman Empire left in Europe. They basically were pushed back to Adrianople down here. And you'll see how much territory Bulgaria has taken over Greece and Serbia. And then you'll see that in the Second Balkan War, the Bulgarians and Serbs had fought each other, the Greeks had fought then, and the Turks had managed to have a bit of a resurgence. So that idea that there was a Balkan League just going to be re-established and to play its part in the war was far from the truth. These groups were very unhappy with each other. And of course the Bulgarians and Greeks both had essentially German kings who were predisposed to Germany in that sense, so whatever their governments thought, there was a tie there. Some of the big figures, Winston Churchill there wearing the uniform, or sort of uniform, pretty councillor's dress, I think, essentially his first Lord of the Admiral Day, resplendent with medals, you can see, all that, you know, junior service in the Northwest Frontier and in the Sudan had led to quite a bit of military experience. The problem was that Churchill, who at the outbreak of war was a major in the Oxfordshire Hussars, actually had thought that he should have been promoted Lieutenant General and sent off to Antwerp to command things there. Now that would have promoted him, I think, six steps in one go. So this is, you know, no great, you know, concerns about his own lack of abilities, whatever they proved to be. Lord Kitchener there, looking, you know, a bit like, there's a phrase used, the weary Titan, and you do get that sense. It said that one of the problems with Kitchener was that he simply couldn't delegate, that he didn't quite understand this idea of a general staff in the first place, but he didn't really like delegating out things, so he even acted as his own private secretary. And of course there is that wonderful story that when he comes to review the Ulster Division, in 1915. He says that the horses that they have with the field ambulance units are all very good horses and too good for field ambulances. They should be sent to the artillery, and he wants 200 of them be sent to the artillery. And about 3 months later, there's a letter comes from asking why have they not been sent to the artillery. So there's a danger that Kitchener gets tied up with the minutiae and loses a sense of the big picture. David Lloyd George, the Welsh wizard, as he was called, Chancellor of the Exchequer, future Minister of Munitions, and Prime Minister, somebody who's very keen on some strategic way out of the quagmire of the Western Front. Maurice Hankey, who bears him as a uniform, as a Colonel of the Royal Marines and is Secretary to the Cabinet, right up until the 30s, in fact. And they're somebody we're already familiar with. Right, I think that's me more or less where I wanted to be now. I've said then about the general staff is broken up in the outbreak of war. What comes in to replace them are what are called in some cases the dugouts. And Caldwell is a good example of that. Caldwell had retired from the army in 1912, but is brought back as Major General and put in charge of the Directorate of Military Operations. It's not a particularly happy case. Some of the others that are there don't perform much better.
Sorry, Tom.
Good afternoon. On behalf of PRONI, I'd just like to apologise to all visitors and customers for the power outage. This was the result of a wider power outage in the area. Apologies again, and hopefully you can get back to your work with no further disruption.
Good. The show will go on. The Chief of the Imperial General Staff in the outbreak of war is a man called Sir Charles Douglas, and again he has some of the same traits to Kitchener, not able to delegate work, and he essentially works himself to death within the first month of war. His replacement then is a man called Sir James Wolfe Murray, who was brought in having been Commander-in-Chief in South Africa. Wolfe Murray wasn't seen as a very active character. Churchill talks about him as Sheep Murray. And that rather says it all. When there's the whole Dardanelles Commission about what had gone wrong at Gallipoli, it turns out that in only one meeting had Kitchener turned to Murray and asked him had he anything to contribute to the discussion, and Wolfe Murray had said, no, he didn't. Which really isn't what you're meant to be there as. Your Chief of the Imperial General Staff is there to advise the government on military policy, and Wolfe Murray is basically asleep on the watch. Kitchener is the Secretary of State for War, the boss must know best. So that's it. Caldwell takes a similar view. Caldwell should then be another independent voice within this, but isn't. So essentially the mixture of dugouts and officers who I think, bar for being the war, wouldn't have got those posts. More able men who were packed off to France would have held them. This isn't a very happy mix. Added to this then, we have a problem of what we could call meek politicians. Asquith, who as Prime Minister is chairing what's talked about then as the War Council, the Dardanelles Committee, what we now think of as a War Cabinet, a small group of ministers making policy, seems to simply approve Kitchener's views at the War Council. He doesn't really ask Kitchener to explain things, he doesn't ask for detailed appraisals, and that really leads to enormous problems, that the politicians are asleep in the watch, most of the military are asleep in the watch, and it's left a handful of enthusiasts to push the idea of the Gallipoli campaign, with really very little planning having been put together. In terms of the planning of the campaign, this 1906 study had obviously concluded it wasn't a very good idea. To ensure the success of an actual attack on the Gallipoli Peninsula, it must be of the nature of a surprise. To secure this, every effort must be made to mislead the enemy, and our own intelligence must be prompt and accurate, or the attempt may result in a severe repulse, is a quote from that. And as John's already said, the intelligence certainly isn't particularly prompt or accurate, and any idea of a surprise goes very early on. That advice was supported by Admiral Olympus, who was the former head of the British naval mission to Turkey, military attaché in Constantinople. He had noticed the numbers of German troops and guns being moved to Gallipoli before the formal Turkish declaration of war in November 1914. And that's something that's worth saying a bit more about the book by Erickson that John was talking about. It's very important on this because Britain and France thought about the Ottoman army as a spent force,
after the First Balkan War, but the addition of a large number of German military advisors and about 60 batteries of Skoda artillery from Austro-Hungary made it a very different force from that that had been defeated in 1912, and that hadn't really been appreciated at the time. The Entente resources then were deemed to be pretty plentiful to take on what was seen as a third, perhaps even a fourth or fifth rate power. The Anzac Corps was training in Egypt, so the idea that they weren't fit to go to France but could be used there. The Royal Naval Division had been reconstituted after a debacle in Antwerp, where a lot of them had ended up being interned in Holland, so that had been re-recruited. A French corps was made up from third rate depot troops. And then there were all these other Kitchener armies and territorial force units that could be sent out that were thought not to be well enough trained to face German troops, along with all these old battleships. So there is this sort of idea that they can be used in Gallipoli and couldn't be used in France. Indeed, the 29th Division becomes a real cause célèbre. It was made up of long service regular soldiers who had been serving largely in India on the outbreak of war, and the French government is very concerned that that unit is not being deployed on the Western Front, and that leads to a bit of a judder really in Anglo-French relations about how that unit's deployed. I'll not say too much about the naval demonstration, which Tom will come on to talk about, but I think what we should say a bit about is just the idea of a sort of slow burn in this campaign. 31st October 1914 is when Turkey declares war on the Entente powers. The 3rd of November, under Churchill's orders, the British squadron bombarded some of the forts at Gallipoli, Cricket, Sedal Bar and Cwm Cal. Now, a number of historians say that Churchill's actions on the 3rd of November are very irresponsible, that this then alerts the Turks. But, I mean, we can just sort of look at the map here. You have one sea route that gets you from the Mediterranean to Constantinople, that's it. You know, you don't have to be a Napoleon to work out that that's your sort of key strategic point and that that's where any Allied attack is likely to come. So the idea that this alerts the Turks is problematic. And Ericsson, who's looked at the Turkish archives, says that actually a lot of this area had been put in a decent state of defence in 1912 when the Turks were expecting a Greek invasion as part of the Balkan Wars. 19th of February then, Carden's force starts to shell the Turkish forts. Tom will talk more about that, and then we actually get the army intervention in April, so we end up with the landings at Cape Helles there. Now, as Keith was saying earlier, the Cape Helles landings bogged down very quickly. They managed to get about a mile inland, and then it settles down to the same sort of attritional warfare that is seen on the Western Front, and there is the question about how to break that. The ANZAC operation hasn't really managed to break it either, so we come to ultimately the landings in Suvla Bay, but there's quite a lot of discussion behind all this. In May 1915, the nature of the British government changes and you end up with a coalition government with some Conservatives being brought in. And one of those who joins at that point is Sir Edward Carson, a name that will be familiar to this audience. Carson joins as Attorney General, but is then a full member of the cabinet and has, you know, things to say about British strategy. Now, Carson was a little unusual amongst Edwardian politicians in that he had no real military background at all. A lot of them had served at least in volunteer units at school or university, but Carson had no formal military experience at all, although he had, of course, been a sort of, well, rather unwilling generalissimo of the Ulster Volunteer Force in 1913-14. He, of course, always said in public speeches that it was Lieutenant General Sir George Richardson that was the commander of the UVF, not him. So there is that Chinese wall. But in Cabinet on the 8th of June, Carson is very concerned about where this campaign's going. He thinks that the entire force should simply be evacuated from Gallipoli, that there's no possibility of any success there. And what Carson's also concerned about are Britain's responsibilities to Serbia, which you might remember from some earlier maps. The Serbs were very much up against it by this point in the war. And basically what British forces land down in Salonika, which is down here, to evacuate the Serbian army. But Carson thinks that with a larger force sent out, the Serbs could hold against the Bulgarians. So he thinks that there is a sort of debt of honour involved in it. So it's quite interesting that Carson, who's often written off in a strategic sense when he becomes First Lord of the Admiralty in 1917, is actually speaking quite a bit of sense in 1915. But he's overruled. The cabinet as a whole goes along with the views of the Dardanelles Committee, which then pushes the idea of the landing in Suvla Bay, further to the north, with the idea that the peninsula can then be cut. The troops in Suvla Bay will be able to push across the peninsula, cut off supplies to Turkish forces down at Cape Ellis, and then that will be the end of the Dudley campaign. Basically, that will be a light victory. The Suvla operation, as we've heard, isn't particularly successful. Stopford, who's the commander of essentially the operation there, Lieutenant General Frederick Stopford, is another one of these dugouts. He had been the constable of the Tower of London, which, as you'll know, is the sort of, you know, retirement gift for senior generals, you know, along with your knighthood and your fat pension now, you get the constable of the Tower of London. He's dug out of that, and when he lands at Suvla Bay, he seems to forget all the basic principles of military history, military lessons, which is to seize the high ground, and the force then ends up bottled up in Suvla Bay and unable to make much of a push forward. The campaign then really bogs down in Suvla Bay, just as it had bogged down at Cape Helles. They manage a link up between Suvla Bay and Anzac here after some attritional fighting, but aren't able to extend it any further. And then, I think this is the point when Hamilton starts to get the reputation of being a bit of a dismal Jimmy, isn't it? Because he's saying that what he needs is something like 90,000 additional troops to really make a push here. The French were taking incredibly high losses in France in the three battles of the Artois in 1915, so things were looking very grim there, and this just isn't really a runner. So the decision that's made by the War Cabinet, argued in one book, certainly by David French, partly to placate Carson, is that Hamilton is sacked and that Charles Munro is brought in as Commander-in-Chief in Gallipoli with basically a remit to evacuate the peninsula. Munro's an interesting character. There's a full biography of him being worked on at the minute, but he had been a pretty successful army commander in France. He later becomes Commander-in-Chief in India, and there's a suspicion that Haig wanted him out of the way because he saw him as a rival. So Munro is seen as a very capable soldier, and he then is the man who takes over after Hamilton. The debate about what to do with Gallipoli then remains unresolved until very late on, 1915. There is a view that most of it should be evacuated. Certainly the Suvla and Anzac Cove areas should be evacuated. But until quite late in the day, Kitchener and a number of the senior naval officers quite like the idea of hanging on to the Cape Helles part here as a sort of Gibraltar, the idea that this could be held as a British sort of fortified position and would be quite good as a naval resource and a naval base. So that's one of the issues that dogs discussions about evacuation until quite late on. But the presence of German submarines in the Mediterranean and ones that have been brought overland and assembled at Trieste in the Austro-Hungarian Empire, that then makes the position of the Royal Navy in the Eastern Mediterranean more and more difficult, so that idea starts to go. And then a number of adverse reports are made about the situation at Gallipoli. Hanke, the Secretary of the Cabinet, goes out there. Kitchener himself goes out and visits. And on the back of their reports, the Cabinet decides on the 7th of December 1915 to evacuate Suvla and Anzac. They're evacuated then the 18th and 19th of December. And on the 23rd of December, it's decided to evacuate Cape Helles itself. And that occurs on the 8th and 9th of January 1916. One of the ironies of the Gallipoli enterprise, of course, is that the evacuations are handled without a single casualty. There's enormously well thought out deception plans which involve rifles with sort of timers set to them so that there's sort of sniper fire kept up, as it seems. Campfires are lit in large numbers and kept going until very late on as the troops get out. But sometimes it's forgotten what that actual evacuation leads to. There is a suggestion that it leaves the Ottoman army with about enough food supplies and enough ammunition to keep their war effort going for an extra year. So much, you know, apart from this idea at the start that this would be a way of kicking the props out from under Germany and a way of getting the Ottomans out of the war, there is a serious suggestion that in logistical terms, this does a lot to sustain the Ottoman war effort. I'm conscious of going a bit over time with our various interruptions there, but a few concluding points. I suppose the very obvious one is the two contemporaries, the Gallipoli campaign seemed to offer a great deal. And the surprise to us today really is that it was seen as a good idea by so many contemporaries. And even in the interwar period, with people like Basil Little Hart writing in the late 1930s, saying that, you know, with a bit more push, with a bit more energy, this could all have worked out wonderfully well. Whereas looking at it now, it just looks to be a catalogue of disasters, with resource issues really just never being sufficient at all. We can understand, I think, the desire of politicians to break out of the stalemate on the Western Front, but as John Gooch has noted, this amateur strategy was no solution to that problem. And even had the Gallipoli campaign been that successful, what would it really have led to? Perhaps the Ottoman Empire out of the war, but it's hard to think that this Balkan League would have come together, that the Austro-Hungarians would have been under any serious pressure. Similarly, there is that issue about the supply of Russia, which is an interesting one to think a little further about, because in 1915 the British Army itself on the Western Front is suffering from a severe shell shortage. Ones are being rushed over from America, but guns are being rationed to 3 and 4 shells a day. So in terms of opening up the supply route to Russia, whether that would have been able to keep Russia in the war with any useful logistical support is another moot point. And I suppose the final point to say is that the amateur strategists in London, Paris, received more support from the troops on the ground and certainly from the Royal Navy than they deserved. And the green troops that were sent out as untried, untested, performed much better than anyone had anticipated. I'll end it there. Thank you.
Another mate of mine, Tom Thorpe. I'm in the London branch of the WFA back at home, and Tom was the chairman of the London WFA. Has come over to Northern Ireland to get married and to work.
To be married,
big heart. And is now the chair of the new branch, the Antrim and Dungan branch of the WFA. And Tom's doing a PhD, still based at King's College in London, on the
56th Division, Small Unit Cohesion. Which I will bore you with later.
London
Territories, my grandfather was in.
Okay, so we look forward to hearing from Tim on the main aspects of the Gallipoli campaign.
Good afternoon. Can everybody hear me?
Yeah.
I just remember a story told to me by a senior lecturer about how one applicant for a job went for a professorship, and their PowerPoint broke down halfway through, and they continued on, and they got the job because they always continue on with slides. And I was fearing I would have to do that. That was when I first met Tim in Kent a couple of years ago. But luckily, I have my slides, so I'm saved. What I'm going to talk about today is essentially just around the naval operations against the Dardanelles defences around sort of February, March 1915. I'm going to skip over bits that we've already covered because we've alluded to a lot of what I will cover. So I will make this reasonably short in that we've probably covered some of the politics and the decision making, but I'll reference that when we get to the relevant bits. Right, so what I'm going to cover is the defences, the plans that were actually hatched for sending the fleets in, how the operations proceeded, and finally the reckoning and some of my own thoughts. Firstly, just thinking about the defences, as has been said, there's a number of forts up these islands here, and you can see that some of these guns are really actually quite big. There's actually 14-inch Krupp howitzers and 9-inch guns, and if you've been to Lough Swilly, there's two old British forts there, and they probably give you a reasonably good idea of what they're like. One's got 6-inch guns, and the other one's actually got 9.2-inch guns, or the gun emplacements for them. So they're certainly worth a visit if you wish, just to give you a local feel there. So essentially what we've got is 20-odd forts built in the 1890s with a large number of guns, roughly 100, 120, ranging between 6, 9-inch and 14-inch guns. So you've got them, and they're organised into three levels. Firstly, there's the outer defences, inner defences, intermediate defences, and then inner here. And you can see from here, these things are actually really quite big. And some of these guns, it's a great website here if you want to go and do a bit more research, navyingallipoli.com. Really, really good. Got some excellent stuff. And then we've got this other battery here up at the, this is on the Asiatic side, known as the Dardanos, which had 550mm or 6-inch guns. So really quite considerable defences. And they were defending two sort of key minefields here, the Kepis field followed by the Straits field. And they had, I think it was 11 lines of mines with 340 individual devices. So these sort of huge, great things. And note this minefield here, which we'll come to eventually. But covering the minefields, you see we have all these mobile howitzers that have been referred to earlier. So to cover the genesis of the operation, firstly, thinking about the Straits, I think it's useful just to think about some of the problems we've already covered. I think firstly, it's already been highlighted that the first issue is once you get into the Straits, how do you supply them? And the only way you can supply them is, certainly in naval terms, is by sending boats the way you come. And Admiral Duckworth, John Duckworth, in 1807, forced the Straits and got into the Sea of Marmara and had this problem. So he had to have, all his supplies had to come through the Straits, and ships got shelled, and he eventually gave up. 1878, Admiral Hornby here, who was Commander-in-Chief of the Mediterranean Fleet, I think wrote a study saying it was not really worth doing. Also, we have similar conclusions in 1895, where the Admiralty were thinking about how they could put pressure on the Ottoman regime to stop massacres of Armenian Christians. Again, in 1906, as Tim referred to, and I think even in 1912, the Italians did a similar study. So it's pretty tough. Now, the key issue is this old chestnut. Now, Nelson talked about you engage a fort, you're a fool. Admiral Thayer Mahan, if you're wondering who this gentleman is, I don't know if that's the correct thing. The American naval theorist, 1911, wrote pretty much the same, that forts taking on ships, forts are going to win, they don't sink. It's a relatively straightforward thing. They come out bigger guns, better armour, and you're a lower target. Bombardment of Alexandria in 1882, the British Navy brought their ships up, bombarded the Alexandria defences all day, and they knocked out of 30 out of the 293 guns in the fort. So actually, it proved relatively ineffective. Admittedly, they achieved their political objectives, so you could say it worked in that sense, but as a technique, it let a lot to be desired. So the plan, it appears to me the naval idea for this, for Churchill's obsession, came from a plan that Maurice Hankey came up with. It was about getting the neutral Bulgarians, the neutral Greeks, and Royal Navy support to invade Istanbul. So Churchill actually here just grabbed onto the naval aspects and thought that would be a viable operation. Now, there are a number of reasons for the thinking. I think we've already covered on one. Firstly, it was political reasons. It would relieve pressure on Russia by giving the Turks a stop, the Turkish armies in the Caucasus attacking the Russians. And the ambassador, Sir George Buchanan, with this wonderful moustache, wrote that he was the British ambassador to the Russian court. Secondly, there was the issue of the Navy was stuck with a pretty bad start to the war. You can see here the Cressy, Abukir and Hogue were all torpedoed by one submarine in one afternoon, with the loss of 1,200 men. You have the Audacious, mined off Lochswilly, still there to this very day, another Irish connection. Bombardment of Scarborough, Whitby and Hartlepool by the German battle cruisers. Battle of Coronel, well, it didn't go well. And also we had the Royal Naval Division, which didn't perform particularly well in the defence of Antwerp, one of Churchill's ideas. Also, I think we've already touched on the Turks being considered military incompetent. You know, they're not you know, Europeans and all the racial ideas which flow from that. You can see from this 1896 Punch cartoon, which says prospectus reorganisation of the Ottoman Empire, and the Sultan says, "Bismillah, make me a limited company?" Question mark. Suppose they'll allow me to join the board after the allotment. The idea that the Turks would consent to this. And then HMS Doris. Now HMS Doris turned up off Alexandretta of Syria, and they sent a demolition party to blow up some railway lines. So this party got ashore, and they were met by a Turkish army unit. And the Turkish army unit insisted that the leader of the expedition become a Turkish officer for the day, and they assisted the Royal Navy blowing up communication lines. So the assumption was that they're not really that good, plus all the other perceptions we've had. Secondly, I think this was seen, this Dardanelles plan seen as a pretty exciting option. And this comes on the background of a lot of sort of ideas of panacea targets. If you remember Bomber Harris in the Second World War, who talked about, you know, we've got to bomb Germany city by city, no panaceas, where Churchill was trying to knock out dams or ball bearings factories and things like this. And these are similar types of schemes. For instance, he thought of sending some old battleships down the Elbe, occupying the belts, these islands here, Bockum Island and Heligoland, right outside the main German naval base. And one to which I alluded earlier was the transportation of Russian army units across the Baltic to the North German coast, who would promptly march on Berlin and the war would be ended. So these are all going, and then we have the artillery question. As we said, I think Churchill actually witnessed the power of German artillery during the siege of Antwerp, if I'm correct. And he saw that these Germans were using these guns and knocking out these Belgian forts. He thought the power of modern artillery could achieve this. But essentially, Germans were using howitzers over a very short distance with observed fire and plunging shots, so they were able to hit these targets rather than this sort of flat trajectory of naval guns, which makes damaging a fixed target or an earth target a lot harder. So, connected to that, they had a number of expendable warships, as Tim was already talking to. This is the Bouvet. It looks like a sort of a Gothic castle with all these wonderful turrets, and this is a colourised photograph, obviously. But there was a number of these ships down there, and they all had big guns. I mean, this has got these 7-inch and 9-inch guns. So in terms of gun power, you can put all these battleships against one target. It makes sense, you know. Connected to that, you could penetrate the straits. They were not invincible. Now, Lieutenant Holbrook here in ELLB-11 managed to penetrate the straits, get through the minefields, and sink a Turkish ironclad a bit further up here. And, you know, so he demonstrated they could be penetrated, and he got the VC for this. Again, it was these sort of exciting ideas that people were grabbed with the Dardanelles. Also, Admiral Carden, who was the commander-in-chief of the Dardanelles Navy, or Navy, I don't know what the actual Navy is called, it's sitting outside of Dardanelles. Anyway, he's in charge of this, and he comes up with a plan in response to a request from Churchill. The straits cannot be rushed, but they can be reduced by a gradual attritional approach. So he comes up with a seven-phase programme to do this. So essentially, Churchill has also got operational backing from the theatre commander. Also, he gets political backing. He puts this to the War Cabinet on the 13th of January, and it all goes silent, and they all become enthusiastic, and you know the fatigue has gone. I think at the end of that meeting, they actually minute that they will ask the Admiralty to produce a plan to invade the Dardanelles with Constantinople as its objective using the Navy. You can work that one out, so it's a rather imprecise order. But essentially, they back it. And I think Kitchen's influence is really important in deciding for a naval option. Firstly, he says, oh, no, there are no soldiers available, and he backs it. And he is seen as the messiah. I mean, I think it's trying to understand how incredible his personal magnetism was. And he was an odd fish. And talking of odd fish, we have this other gentleman here who was Jackie Fisher, who was first Sea Lord, rather than first Lord of the Admiralty. And first Sea Lord, that's essentially the professional head of the Royal Navy. Man who's impeccable service, a brilliant guy, but also really difficult. And also a bizarre looking bloke. And he was against the operation. But finally, Kitchener managed to persuade him to back it. They could say, you can always pull out if it goes wrong. So you've also got backing from the Admiralty at this very senior level. So the idea is somehow Churchill's project is true, but he also had everybody else with him. So, to the operations. And this is where it gets exciting. So firstly, it's going to give you an idea of what type of ships they had down there. Note these names, they will occur later. So you have, you know, sort of pre-dreadnought type HMS era system, again, 12-inch guns and all these sort of guns encasements. You have HMS Ocean, indeed, or HMS Irresistible. Again, very similar type of design, but complementing that, they had the most up-to-date, the most modern battleship in the world, HMS Queen Elizabeth, with 8 15-inch guns, fired by oil, not coal, huge, you know. So this is a sort of Second World War-type battleship that we're all familiar with. And they also had a number of French pre-dreadnoughts, like the Gaulois, the Souffern, and the Bouvet, which will all feature shortly. So, you know, lots of guns. And then The operations commence in late February, and they start by attacking the forts on the outer sides. And you can see here, I think this is Concale fort on the European side, and they actually destroy these guns, land parties ashore, and these guns are destroyed. And it all starts quite well. And then they start moving into the inner forts. So these are the forts up either side of the strait, and problems start to emerge. They find that actually trying to hit these forts is actually surprisingly difficult. The fire control and target acquisition systems are very difficult. You can't see the forts because of the haze or the weather, the fact they're very low to the ground, they merge into the environment. It's not like looking at a 500-foot battleship at 12 miles using modern optical rangefinding. It is a lot harder. This is not unsurprising, but you know, the Americans, and I think during the Normandy and some of the Pacific campaigns, they got around this by much more sort of close observation of forward shot, so they became much more accurate. They were also using armoured piercing ammunition, again not so good against forts, and a lot of these old dreadnoughts had worn guns, and Admiral Brodie said the crews were green with age. So not particularly good. So, you know, up to mid-March, things are not going well. So I think it was estimated that 2 or 3% of the rounds actually hit their targets. If you think about the number of forts, say 20 or 30, and the number of guns, say 120, it's going to take a lot of ammunition. And again, these ships would only carry 100, 120 rounds per gun. And after 200, 300 rounds, you'd have to change the gun. So, you know, these things are, it's a long, long haul. And the other problem they had was the curse of the non-shown howitzer. So essentially they had, as Tim was talking about, all these mobile howitzers, 150mm guns, standard field pieces. Again, the straits are 5-6 miles wide, you could probably hit most things in the straits. And they moved these batteries around with buffalo teams, and they had decoys. And they, you know, they never knew where these shells were coming from. So these are important. The other problem they had to do, simultaneously engaging the forts, which were protecting the mines, was clear the mines. But you can't clear the mines unless you clear the forts, but that's the problem they have. So, two main belts of mines here. So, what do they get to clear mines? What would you get if you were the biggest navy in the world with the most professional name? You get North Sea trawler crews and fishermen. So they get these guys from a place like Hartlepool, Grimsby, Newcastle, and they put them in boats in the straits and send them up. Now, it doesn't take a genius to work out this. It doesn't really bode well. But what they were meant to be doing was towing a wire between two kites and two ships. So you'd send them up, cut the mines, and then shoot them. So this is how it works. As you notice, it's Beagle-class destroyers doing this, not trawlers. Now, this is where the problems emerge. These trawlers actually had a top speed of between 6 and 7 knots. No, that's not such a problem. But when you're fighting a 4-knot current coming down from the Black Sea, that means you're doing about 2 or 3 knots. Okay, so that's one problem. Second problem, you've got crews who aren't soldiers. And all these sailors keep panicking and the boats turn around. And you've got commanders in the boats who's never done minesweeping. So it's a gallant attempt, a little progress, unlike my picture. Essentially, there's a number of operations, so they do it over, I think, 7 or 8 attempts. And for instance, they on the 14th, they get two of the minesweepers get their kites down, and then 4 are put out of action by artillery fire. So these things go on, and you know, they try and get volunteers from crews. And the North Sea fishermen have a pretty rough time of it. And Roger Keyes, who we've mentioned earlier, blames them for not doing it. But, you know, it really beggars belief that this is what you do to clear mines. But anyway. Oh, dear. Right. So, we get to mid-March. Very little progress. We don't know how many forts we've knocked out. So we're thinking of a new strategy. Now, bear with me on this thing. So this the plan that emerges from a couple of the battleship captains is a concentrated attack on the forts. So we're going to attack the forts, concentrate artillery fire, then we're going to send the minesweepers in, and we're going to do it in an attritional way. This will work. Remember Churchill sending cards and telegrams all the time saying, why can you knock out these forts? 200 casualties are a small price to pay. These are actual, you know, the quotes he comes up with. So again, it's now Carden actually has a nervous breakdown. Something happens to him. He leaves. He resigns. and goes off, and he's taken, his replacement is de Robeck. Is it Robeck? Robeck. No, we call him Robeck, and he is of Swedish descent, a fighting admiral, probably not the brightest, but, you know, anyway, he does his best. So, bear with me on this. What happens is that the battleships are organised into a number of lines, and they sweep up the straits and then come round. So they turn to starboard and come round. So this is the idea. So they're organised in this useful list I found on Wikipedia. So you've got the British and the French, and these ships here do the various supporting thing. But this is going to take all day on the 18th. So it starts at 11. Mentioned a picture of the Queen Elizabeth, but not to worry. So it commences at 11, and by 1:30, around 1:30, yes, the forts begin to reduce their fire. This is a balloon tender. I'm not certain what ship it is, but essentially things are beginning to go well. 13:45, we don't have a picture, but it's meant to be there. Firing ceases. 13:54, disaster. Now, that's meant to be the Bouvet capsizing, but Bouvet is now capsizing. I did have four other images of this ship rolling over. But essentially that one of these wonderful Gothic French battleships, the one I showed the colour photograph of, hits something, or an explosion happens, and it capsizes. Now they accept casualties. They know that attacking these forts is going to take a number of battleships. So not to worry, we move on. At 4:00, HMS Inflexible suffers an explosion. Okay, carry on. 4:10, HMS Irresistible suffers an explosion. And this is it actually sinking. There are actually very few sailors are actually killed in some of these. And the operation continues, and finally at 6:05, HMS Ocean suffers an explosion. Now, what is causing these problems? Now, a number of sort of books, if you look at Scientific American, this is the sinker of the Bouvet Irresistible Notion. Now, the Allies blame Mr. De Leon, so Oscar De Leon. If you know your salsa music, Oscar De Leon is a Colombian African salsa king who's done some wonderful, wonderful sort of salsa work in the 80s. But anyway, he did not have a relative who was designing these sort of torpedoes. These essentially are floating mines which float down with the current. And it was thought that the dastardly Teutons had, and their Turkish puppets had used these against the battleships. But actually what had happened is that the Turks actually observed the battleships turning to starboard, and you can see all these various ships where they sunk, and that line of mines that I pointed out earlier were laid by this ship. It is actually not like this in real life. It is slightly more in focus. But they've got this little mine sweep, obviously with the mines at the back, and you can actually go and visit. It's called a Nusrat, and so they put these mines down, and they noticed where the Allies were turning and knocked out three. And a number of other ships suffered damage from various bits of artillery.
So not the case that was done very, very shortly before they actually commenced the operation. Like, it was done a couple of days before, because they checked for mines and there weren't any there, and then they put them down overnight, and then more or less the next day they went in and were sort of a bit surprised to find them there.
Yeah, the dates I had was that they were laid on the 8th and 9th of March, and the attack went in on the 15th, so they'd been there for
maybe a week.
But the idea was that they were meant to spot them, and apparently it was very clear and surprising that you couldn't see the mines. So again, it's one of those challenges. But it shows that the Turks were not just stupid savages. They were actually sophisticated, and they demonstrated far more competence than I think they would be credited. So, 19th of March, do we carry on with the attack? Churchill, surprisingly, says yes, and says, Robeck, it's up to you. I think this is Robeck here. But he thinks he's going to be sacked after losing a large number of capital ships. And Hamilton and Braithwaite, both sceptical about the Navy's attempts to take the Straits, suggest they wait for the army. So the attack's called off. Now, in a way, is that a good decision? I don't know. Could the Straits have been taken? I suppose, in some ways, they could have done, but you'd lose a lot of warships. So I think probably not. The actual number of guns knocked out, 176 guns in action on that day, and you can see there is some damage here. Only 8 apparently were knocked out. That's the figure I found, which is quite startling. The key point, that a lot of these guns actually were running low on ammunition. The Turks have fired 2,000 rounds, and some of the big pieces were down to 17, 30 rounds. So you didn't have much left. Medium howitzers similarly had major ammunition problems. So the guns couldn't shoot, but the minefields were still intact. So they maybe could have taken it, but who knows. So I would say a Turkish victory. I do have a picture of Ataturk there. It was a Turkish victory for 120 casualties, some three battleships, and in a way gave the Turkish defenders a sense of morale that they could take on the European powers. There was a quote I found in a book about the war, and it said that the myth of invincibility that the Turks held of the British and the French since the Crimean War was shattered. Now, whether that's true or not, I don't know. But, you know, it certainly gave them morale. I think there's a lot about their morale collapsing on the artillery. It was assumed they'd all run away after it was done. I mean, these notions of racial superiority that we find offensive today were completely natural for all these people. So who was to blame on this wonderful operation? We have Churchill here who's been decapitated. Everybody blames Churchill, but I think you've got to think that he got professional backing from the operational commander and the Admiralty, and also from Parliament. I mean, he certainly was at fault, but also I think, more importantly, it was the Navy in the way it was implemented. I mean, this is a Beagle-class destroyer, and they apparently had these down there in the fleet. And why this wasn't sweeping, as opposed to minesweepers, and, you know, wasting time and surprise and all those things, I don't know. But that's where I will conclude and give you a bit of static there to...
Thanks very much. Ian Montgomery from the Public Record Office in Northern Ireland. I've only met Ian today for the first time, but I can tell you one thing about him. I emailed Tom to say, don't know this part of Belfast very well, Tom, where can I park my car? And about 2 minutes later, an email from Ian Montgomery telling me websites, maps, everything I needed to know. So that's the deadly efficiency of our we're going to hear about the whole news here.
Well, that's caused a laugh at my colleagues in the back of the room. Possibly I was doing nothing else out there. Thank you very much. I'm something of a charlatan on this occasion after five very distinguished historians and five very, very good papers. You know, I have an archivist. The role of the archivist is at best the role of the Army Service Corps in the Army. We dump the red wagons at great speed, dump the stuff and then head back to the areas as fast as possible. We supply the ammunition for the historians to throw, basically. But I'm going to look at some of the sources. This has been, as you probably know, unless you're living under a rock somewhere, a decade of centenaries. We've been marking centenaries on a number of things important in Irish history at the minute, including the First World War and parts of the First World War. As part of our sort of contribution to that, we've been trying to get people to look at the original sources, the sources that we have here, which bear on this. We have produced the Gallipoli First World War sources, which should be on your chair when you come in, which lists all the stuff which we do have bearing on the First World War, which is a much wider range of material than people actually thought we had in here. So if you don't have one, see you later, I can get you a copy of that. And we've been doing extracts from some of our documents on the website, something called Irish Voices from the First World War. I've called it a blog. My more technically savvy colleagues could tell me it's not a blog, but it's still going a blog, which is just been extracting accounts month by month from the various sources in here, which I think illustrate what's been going on. So, so the emphasis for PRONI has been on the sources. The centenary thing is a bit of a treadmill. It's my personal opinion on that. You know, where the centenary coming up, you have to do something. It's been good. Centenaries are good, and they focus attention on things. The press and the media are very fond of them. But I do have one concern, is that we don't just leave it at the centenary. If it's worth talking about Gallipoli this year, it's worth talking about Gallipoli next year, and in the future there's more work to be done. As we're coming out of the day, I'm getting there's a lot of disputes, but there's still a lot of controversies, a lot of different views about what's happening there. So there's more work to be done. I'm now going to actually take you through some of the sources in here, very, very, very briefly, because I'm always getting out in the afternoon, just to illustrate, highlight and throw light on various aspects of this. Not as an expert on the Gallipoli, but just going through it myself, transcribing them, working on the transcriptions, and what's come out of it for me. So there's a copy of this month's blog, also should be on the site if I print enough of them. If not, again, maybe there's one later. I've looked at some of the sources we have bearing actually on the campaign.
The first one is very relevant to what Tom has been saying. It's a journal kept by a guy called Octavius William Andrews. He was surgeon captain, that to say, he's a Navy doctor with the rank of captain. He'd actually retired from the Navy just before the war, but he comes back during the war as whatever the naval equivalent of a dugout is, drops a rank to commander, and is put on one of the old pre-Dreadnought battleships, HMS Prince George. Now this journal, I should remember to say, is actually on display. We have a brand new exhibition case out in the main foyer, and my colleagues have put this particular journal in that case. We'll go around a little bit later. I was very thoughtful of them because I wanted to check some details before this talk, before the case, but there you go. That's coordination for you. But anyway, Andrews put together this journal. Now, it's not a coherent journal. He was putting together source material. I think he probably intended to write an account of this. Now, I know he did publish later in life a sort of biography, Memories and Recollection of a Sailor's Life type of book, which I haven't seen. It's available in the British Library and a couple of other places. But he was obviously putting together this source material. So it's his own accounts of what happened, what he saw from the ship, HMS Prince George, and also copies of orders and accounts from other officers, copies of French newspapers, translations of Turkish newspapers. So it was actually bringing together various types of material on this. I've selected for the transcription a couple of the accounts for this period, just to give you a flavour of them. The first one, we talked about the mines. He has includes a report on the minesweeping operations on the night of the 13th and 14th of March, before that main attack by the battleships, which we were talking about a few minutes ago. They did attempt to send these trawlers through to do some minesweeping. And it's included a report from Lieutenant Brendan Cox, Royal Navy Reserve, who was on one of the trawlers. They put a few Navy officers, professional Navy officers, on the trawlers to try and coordinate what's going on. And it's a very good, very factual, straightforward officer's account of what's going on, but very, very readable, I think, and it gives you very dry, very factual, very give you a good idea of what they were up against, with these small trawlers going up in the Dardanelles under very heavy fire in the starting the afternoon and getting into the dark. So he says, about 3:15, they go up the Dardanelles. The first shots were fired from howitzers on the European side from the top of the hill. Going to the heavy fire on the searchlights and the other trawlers being turned around, at about 4 p.m. I turned to port, having been under fire for 3/4 of an hour, and stopped the engines for number 10 trawler to come aside and take a sweep. This is the sort of rope that they put between two trawlers to try and pick up the mines. At this time, the wheelhouse had been holed twice, and the trawler had been struck several times aft. I sent William Henry Young, acting boatswain, aft to get the sweep out. He found one man with both legs shot off. Off the single man, Charles Jeffreys of Prince George, winded both sides. I went aft then as nothing was being done, and whilst aft got wounded whilst trying to get the trawler's crew off. I then went back to the wheelhouse to give the skipper directions on his course to get away. I found the helmsman lying on the deck wounded in the head, and the skipper was steering himself. I then went aft to see if it was possible to get the sweep out. They could not hold of anyone to do it, so I told the skipper to go full speed ahead and hailed number 10 trawler and told him it was impossible to get the sweep out, and the skipper and myself were the only people left on deck. So it gives you an idea of what they're trying to do in a small wooden trawler under fire, trying to get this sweep out. And he talks about trying to get men from another boat to come on and help them, but they've all been wounded as well. So in the end, they have to be taken off by a destroyer, the crew's taken off, and the skipper alone is able to get the trawler back down to Trendos, which was the base area. And he then gives details of the casualties. So a very good, very, very dry, but a very good little picture of what it was like, that minesweeping operation. They were under fire the whole time from the shore batteries. They couldn't retaliate the fire because they didn't have large guns on the trawlers. They had to try and dodge the artillery fire, get the sweeps out and get the mines. So that is more or less a failure. There's a short interlude on Prince George, where the Prince George goes back to get refueled and then to find the ship's cat. The ship's cat had deserted onto the collier. So there's a little bit in the journal about how they had to go back and try and find the cat and bring it back up again. So just to show you that the Royal Navy always has to get its priorities right. No cat left behind. So after that, they turn up and they take part in this big account that Storm was telling us about with the fleet of battleships. And then there's a very interesting account in it written by a Major Early, who's an artillery officer who'd been put aboard to Prince George. Presumably the idea is, since we're up against the artillery, get a professional artillery officer on to give his views on what the Turkish
until he was doing so. He gave us a very interesting account. I've only given part of it in this. A very interesting account and a very interesting lessons learned report. He's not that impressed with the Navy. To be honest, I've met with the Navy and their right-wing fighting artillery, so he has some things to say about that. But his account, he says, he was on the foretop of the French Yard as they go up the line. He examined the forts against the Straits of Mcglasses. They had been most terribly knocked about. This is this earlier attack that we heard about the Churchill ordered. I understand most of the guns had been destroyed by demolition parties landed by from the fleet after the bombardment. Well, that was a bit optimistic, it turned out. And he talks about what the forts looked like. And he mentions, you know, that there's lots of raging points for the Navy to fire out. The battleships are put in the lines and go up the straits in line to Brest with their pinnaces, their sort of small boats in front of them trying to pick off any mines. And then the enemy opened fire, as he says, from the Asiatic stand. We opened fire with forward 6-inch guns. From my position, not a soul would be seen on board this ship. Perfect silence now and then, broken by a voice from the upper top only. I cannot make out a Turk or a gun. We might be up watching a cinema show. Perfectly blue sea, pretty woods on the shore, port hand, sun shining, destroyers ahead, shots all around other ships, an occasional report on a column of water throwing up. So this is one of the points you mentioned. They can't actually see the Turks. They can't see anybody. The shells are just coming over the horizon and they can't get any actual bearing on them. Turks making quite good practice on a destroyer ahead of us from, I think, the Asiatic shore. Tramp taking a battery there after some fire on the destroyer comes. You occasionally hear a shell whistle over. 2 p.m. French battleship Bouvet about 400 yards from us. We had turned and were proceeding towards the entrance. They were turning back at the stage on our port quarter. Struck a mine. Immediately took a big hit to starboard, lay on her side for a few seconds, then turned a complete semicircle showing her keel, and then went down by the stern, lifting her bow in the air. I personally did not see the explosion. As the Queen Elizabeth was firing, I thought it was her. I'd been admiring the Bowman a minute before, and so she went down about 3 minutes from the time she was struck. It seemed to be much less when I saw her after being struck. I thought she was under starboard helm. So a great shock there at the speed in which these big, big capital ships could be destroyed. It's an echo of what happens there at Jutland. These huge, big ships cost an enormous amount of money, state of the art, and suddenly they're gone in one shot. So Bouvet, a complete battleship, knocked down about in 3 minutes, just by a mine. So you can see the shock there for people watching. All available steamboats dashed in her directions, followed by destroyers. A shot fell about 300 yards in Prince George's steamboat and was on its way. About 60 survivors were rescued and brought aboard the French battleship. He goes on, it gets worse. 12:30, I noticed the Inflexible on fire. The fire was quickly subdued. We steamed out of the screens and were opposite Kankal. My attention was drawn to the French of Galois, which had been set at this to starboard. Destroyers were hurrying to her in one French battleship. So he didn't fit. The Inflexible also had to be assisted to trend us and she arrived safely. At about 5 p.m., Ocean ordered to close an Irresistible, which was in the Straits and was, you understand, it struck a mine. Both sea and the ocean had been lost through strike, and at 9 p.m. we heard that both sea and the ocean had been lost through striking mines. Again, this is an echo that happens a couple of times. One ship's hit, another ship goes to a rescue, it's hit as well. This is what happens in 1914 when we used three cruisers, Crescent, Barrow, and Hooge. One of them's hit, the other two ships close on her to help, and they're hit in turn. So actually, after that, the Royal Navy gave an order to say that if a ship is hit, you don't go back, you leave her, you just let her sit there because you can't risk another ship. They hadn't learned that lesson at this stage. They were closing on the ships that had been hit, and there's also another ship that's been hit. So you're getting this chain reaction of one ship after another going down. So again, this is all going to pieces around them. So the ocean's been hit, and then at 6 p.m. they were actually back at the base. This ended an action which has cost us dear, and which I fear we shall never know what damage we did to the enemy. The Turkish shooting was extremely bad, except for the howitzers, and I feel absolutely convinced they have no range finders and simply use scores and bearings, as shots fell time after time in the same place, no ships were near. So what he says is the Turks don't have sights here. They're firing on a grid point, they're firing off a map onto a point, which is a sort of primitive way of doing it. But if you're in a ship which has to go through that particular point or narrow area, that's actually quite an effective defence. So he's saying, even though the Turks aren't being that sophisticated, it's extremely effective because they're just dropping shot on the area where the ships had to be, and that's where they're taking out so many ships. The howitzers were very much better served, as were the field batteries. And when the Turks first opened howitzer firing, this with them, not a very, very unpleasant for
And this is a Queen Elizabeth, as I said, it was a big modern ship. That's the one the British couldn't afford to lose. And she's taken out of there out of the battle, thankfully, early on. So an interesting sort of account from a professional naval officer. He does another report, sort of lessons learned report. And one of the things he says, rather controversially on that, is he said, we're wasting a huge amount of money building shore defences. These huge big fortress on places. All you need is some field guns, because you cannot get the field gun from the ship. You cannot spot them. You can't see where they are. If you do spot them, they move. And he says they are very effective against ships. So interesting, an interesting account there. There's other accounts of the battle in there from other people. They make the same points about how difficult it is getting it actually through there, and about the losses. Some of them are hit and don't actually sink. I won't sort of go on any more of those, but they do give you a first-hand account, and they emphasise the point both of how difficult it is actually in this very narrow area. And actually, the artillery officer earlier, again, one of the other points he made, he said, this is just like the land battle, then you're forced to a narrow defile, a narrow valley. You put out flanking force and take the high ground on the other side. There's madness. You wouldn't send a military force into a narrow valley with landing on both sides, and that's what we're doing here. That's what's going on. So at least some people were actually saying that. And the other point is about the mines. It does make that point. We can't simultaneously mine sweep, take out these compartments. And he said, on top of all this, if the Germans get a submarine in the middle of all this, on top of it, we're completely wiped out, you know, because you can't fight three battles at once. So that is that's the naval side of it, and it is a very good account that by Andrews, probably worth somebody taking a further look at, because he's very detailed, a number of very detailed accounts of the campaign into it. Second source I used was a letter from Major Jocelyn Ryan. He is with the 1st Sixkirka Rifles. Now, you mentioned, full story's not being told about this. When I was doing a quick bit of research last night, and put this together, very difficult to find anything out about that Indian brigade. There's an Indian brigade sent over to reinforce the Australians, I think, at the shoulder. And very little that's actually been written about them. You could read a couple of whole books, and I can think of one book, actually, which doesn't mention them at all. But the world was an Indian brigade. There are Indian Army troops. Jocelyn was his nephew of Mrs. Caroline White of Loch Britland. The Whites of Loch Britland were a Catholic gentry family. The papers in here, quite interesting family unions. Jocelyn, I don't know anything more about him, whether he's from Ireland or not, but he sends this letter home to her in August when he's on a hospital ship. And he gives an account of an overview of what the Gurkhas went through on the 1st of May. He mentioned they landed on the 1st of May, so the first of the reinforcements after the initial landings. He said they were under fire right from the start when they got down. Justin, as you'd say, is very matter of fact, very, very correct, very, very officer. Where the party lines are the guy. They were used as reserve troops for a few days, and he mentioned that they observed the New Zealanders attack. It's interesting, a couple of these accounts, very few references to any of the Australians in this, but a couple of mentions of the New Zealanders, and it's interesting that they did make a distinction, and I know nothing annoys New Zealanders more than being nothing of the Australians, but it's interesting that a couple of these guys mention New Zealanders particularly, but none of them mention Australians doing anything. But there you go. I'll pass it on to Australians colleagues next week. And he mentions, we're talking about newspapers, we're talking about the newspaper accounts this morning. He mentions, the reports. As you know from the newspaper, he said, the news in the papers as a general rule is one mass of fabrications. And I've read accounts of crook recharges by my battalion. Nothing of the sort has ever happened. Also how the men avenge their officers. Complete rot from beginning to end. So, interesting, there's an officer writing home, I'm not a very sort of controversial one, but he's saying the newspaper accounts are all rubbish. And of course, the Gurkhas are victims of this more than any other regiment, of this nonsense of being written in the newspapers about them making charges with knives and all the rest of it. Utter complete nonsense. The Gurkhas are professional soldiers, they always act in a professional way, and nobody was trying to manipulate armed with knives. But he's saying this is just a report that was coming back. Now, the Gurkhas actually do a very good attack early on, but there was a point called Gurkha's Bluff, which is mentioned, they do actually take an important ridge with a very good action, but it's not this nonsense of charging forward with knives and all the rest of it.
So Rand goes on to talk about the trench warfare. He said it's very monotonous. One digs and snipes day and night. The Turks are expert snipers, and it took us some time and costing a good many more before we got the better of them. But when we were left, the trenches didn't leave, I think, with the top dog. Our men did quite cute at it. There was one sniper we couldn't get who'd done a lot of damage. Eventually, one of my men thought of a plan. The body of one of our dead snipers was lying in an exposed position. He volunteered to crawl to it, pretend to bring it in. Before he went out, he posted a good shot away on the flank. Then he crawled forward. The Turkish sniper showed himself to have a shot at our chap, but got a bullet through the head from our flank men. So that's, it's dramatic enough, but that's a sort of more planned sort of operation, and that's the way you have to do to take out snipers. Somebody has to take a hell of a risk to actually go forward and present the target and hope the other sniper will take it. And then he talks about this talk on this attack on Gorka Bluff. He just says we had an exciting battle, but held one away from beginning to end. He talks about the fire, the naval ships giving support fire and all the rest of it. Great battle, they took the place, they were then pushed back out by a Turkish counterattack, then they pushed back in again. So I won't go into all that, as you said, it is fairly matter of fact. Interesting point, just in the middle of the letters, he says, just before the bombardment stopped and our time to go forward arrived, I met a padre quite by accident and went to confession and Holy Communion. We have a special dispensation which frees us from fasting before Holy Communion. So it's just an incidental thing, but you know, religion is still important to very many men here. We're stopping to talk about, you know, taking communion and the religious element of the campaign. It did remind me, one of the best sort of accounts, older books on Gallipoli, I think anyway, is Tell England by Raymond, but it's a very, very good account, probably the 1920s, of the Gallipoli campaign, from the point of view of a padre, a clergyman, and he talks about, you know, the men relying on the religion on the communion service. So it's interesting that little echo there. Rand ends his account, he gives a fairly graphic account of what's going on the casualties. He talks they were there day and night until the 5th of July. He says, he says when they're finally taken out, a very different 6th Gurkha rifles to the one that started. However, honour and glory isn't won without sacrifice something, and we have won honour and glory, and the regiment has made a great name for itself. So it's worth remembering that men did actually make statements like that without any irony or postmodern irony about it, you know, unselfconsciously. Not as part of the Bristol campaign. Some of them still did think in those terms, you know, it's about the regiment, it's the honour and glory, we have survived and we have actually achieved something. So, and you will get that coming through letters. The assumption is that when you get into the contemporary letters, you will get the real truth, which is all about the pain and cynicism and the rest of it. Sometimes it is, but some of it is also, you will get guys like this who are still, you know, who still feel what they're doing is worthwhile and they still believe in what they're doing. Third account is probably one of the more dramatic ones. James Pollock from Ballymoney. Well, no, he's not from Ballymoney. He's from my mind's gone blank. He's not from Ballymoney. Because I know if I say this, somebody will come up and tell me this later. Ballyclare, he's from Ballyclare. That's a typo, sorry. I apologise unreservedly now for being Ballyclare for that one. He's from Ballyclare. He joined 6th Royal Irish Rifles, which is part of the 10th Irish Division, and he was a machine gun officer during the campaign. After Gallipoli, he joins the staff. His staff officer ends up in Palestine with, I think, 54th Division. After the war, he joins the Colonial Service, and he stays on in Palestine with the British administration. And he is the last British official, last British government official, to leave Israel in 1948 when the new state of Israel is formed. He does the transitional arrangements, and he's based in Haifa. His papers are in here. There's only one historian I know has looked at, Tom Segev. So his papers are there if anybody wants an interesting perspective on formation of the State of Israel. Quite an important figure in that those last days of Israel in 1948. But this is him in his young days as a young lieutenant. He keeps a diary. It's a very scrappy diary here, which is transcribed, and so you say the transcription done was done by a colleague of a volunteer transcriber, and he has done a very, very good job on it. Not here, unfortunately, but it was a very difficult thing to transcribe. It's a very scrappy little sort of notebook, field service notebook, and he kept these notes on it.
This is a bit incoherent, but you'll find at the end why he's possibly a bit incoherent. They, 6th Royal Irish, they land with the 10th Division. They're in action straight away, trying to get the high ground. It's over, probably all know that story. So he says, first entry, 6th of August, my birthday and what a day. There's a big offensive tonight. We've been under shellfire and snipers all day. We've only had a few casualties, one officer and about six men. While getting water for the section, I was helping a New Zealander down when a shrapnel hit in front of us, but forgot to burst. Tonight the fire was awful, all high explosives from 75mm gun. The fight to get water was awful, and the water tanks are under very hot fire, but we lost nobody. Saturday the 7th, last night we came up into Rest Gully, where we dug in again. All the stores and things belonging to the Lancasters were lying there, and I thank heaven there was some water. I believe we may stay here all day and night also. Went back to Shrapnel Gully for some ration things, as I leave my kit there. Sunday the 8th, there's been a new and very successful landing up the north of Salt Lake. Wasn't that successful? We were under orders to move to 5 minutes' notice. It is very hot. We moved along a long sap, came to a New Zealand hospital, and there we saw the mound we have to attack. We stayed for 1.5 hours in the mound. Trucks got onto us with shrapnel, and D Company lost men. We came along our sheltered grounds all night, and we're now really under fire in a hollow place. We attack at dawn. And Monday the 9th, what a day. We came up close to the firing line. A staff officer yelled at me to get my guns into action on a ridge and said he was a machine gun officer. I did it in 30 minutes. More than half of A Company are gone and there's no report from B or D. A battalion advanced just as I got up the ridge and were nearly all wiped out. I shot one sniper, Pettigrew got two. There's very little for us to do with the guns. I can't get ammunition or water. The Hampshires are getting full into the fight and it's off the ceiling going down before the shrapnel. It's reported the Turks are going to attack. Tuesday the 10th, my God, what a night. We can't last long at this if some reinforcements don't come. We drove off one attack. A Company are nearly all gone. We were attacked about 5:30 again and lose every, and this is when it starts to break up and get coherent. Something about my two guns. I was shot about 7 or 8 in the head. The commanding officer and all the 3 and 4 officers are gone. I'm on a hospital ship. And that's where it ends. That's where he's taken out again. So how did he manage to write that at all? I do not know, but I give you a very vivid telescopic love tonight. For a very young officer, he was just already done his training at Trinity with 10th Frontier Officer, straight out into that as machine gun officer. And then a few days, after 5 days, wounded in the head and out again. So I'm very lucky to survive. So it gives you an insight of what it's like on the front line. It's not coherent, it's not pretty, but that, you know, that gives you an idea of the reality of these sort of operations. Next one, briefly, Lieutenant Evelyn Shirley. This is the Shirley family of Carrickmacross, County Monaghan. Family which is still living down there. Shirley served the Warwickshire Yeomanry, part of the 6th Mounted Division. They go out to Gallipoli as a dismounted unit fighting as infantry, much to their own disgust. One of his earlier letters is talking about how he had brought all his hunting gear over to the Jupiter station and was quite disgusted having to leave it behind when they were off to Gallipoli. But then he lands in Egypt feeling very optimistic. They land the 19th of August. We got here yesterday morning, landed early, not long before the shells flying about. They're not good shells and don't always go off, and when they do, they don't do a great deal of harm. So he's writing to his mother, I should say, so he's been quite optimistic. He does mention they've lost some men, but at this stage he's fairly optimistic. The noise, of course, is tremendous, the shells whistling overhead. It's peculiar in first alarming cessation, but today we don't notice them as much as we did yesterday. So he talks about we're sleeping and living in houses dug out of the ground. He talks about the climate around, very different from Egypt. It's quite bracing here. Defender is a bit more than bracing. We'll be going up to the firing line shortly. It talks about the early sort of battles in the background. In the 24th of August, the tone is changing. We have been through an awful hot time. Started off on Friday left and have been at it ever since. Only getting our clothes off and have a bit of a wash this morning. We're just behind the front line at present in dugouts on the side of the hill. Saturday afternoon, we went through a perfect inferno with shrapnel shell. Goodness knows why we weren't all killed. Granville and York both hit, and our men caught it very badly. Granville's thigh was fractured, and York had a bullet through the leg. We don't seem to have done any good by Saturday and Sunday's fight. I'm very fit, though. How anybody escapes being hit by the advances, can't imagine. Shrapnel and bullets simply screaming all around them. And this, you know, I'm sure his mother was really enjoying this. The actual holding of the front trenches when you're not making the advance seems a matter of comparative safety, although he does say I haven't actually been in the front lines. The men behave splendidly under fire and are very cheery, although we live in a height of discomfort. I suppose we shop here for a bit. The Turkish snipers are a perfect pest. They seem everywhere and are formulated to get shot from behind and in front. An extraordinary country full of hills. In the 13th of October, we're now in the front line of trenches and it is not an overpleasant spot. We came up with the last, which is only about half a mile move from where we were before. We fancy come up, took off a bit of trench. He talks about very lights. The bullets going to the part of the trench all the time. The worst trial is a trench mortar that the Turks should throw big bombs at us, though the effect was more frightening. You can practically no shelling here, but quantities passing overhead making a beastly noise. The flies are shocking, but it is not to be wondered as the ground on the front is strewn with corpses, which have been lying here since the attacks of the 6th of August. This is on the 13th of October. The smell is not pleasant. Every day seems to be just alike here, just doing nothing and no exercise. One officer is always on duty day and night, and the rest of the time one really does nothing except eat and sleep. One is up part of every night on duty to generally take a nap in the daytime. The Turks never show themselves. I mentioned it in my own, they never actually see a Turk because you know they're deep in the trenches. And he mentions an European brought down. So it's an interesting factual account, but it does go from this optimism. He sort of missed the point, but he does say somewhere, I'm revising what I said in my first letter about we're making progress, we're not making any progress, and it's quite obvious this late in the war, they know by now they're not going anywhere. The mutiny attacks are failed, and they're just holding on in the trenches, waiting for somebody to make a decision. And this situation is getting worse. And one of the points about Gallipoli that comes through in these, Gallipoli is a very extreme climate, very, very hot and dry in the winter, very, very cold. Our friends, summer, very, very cold in the winter. So we're getting both in the extremes of temperature, and needless to say, the army wasn't prepared for either contingency of weather, as it never is. Fifth source is a rather more sceptical and cynical character, one Captain Basil Brooke. And this is indeed the Basil Brooke who has later become Prime Minister of Northern Ireland. During the war, most of the war, he was an ADC to General Julian Brigg, one of the better known, better respected generals, who ended up commanding the Canadian forces. Brooke had been an officer in 10th Hussars, and which was Byng's old regiment, which is why I think he was sort of brought in to be his ADC. He stayed with Byng for most of the war, and they seem to have a very good relationship. Brooke himself in one of his letters that Byng is probably the nicest man that they've ever met. Brooke, as we'll see from this, is a bit more outspoken and a bit more cynical. The war affects Brooke quite badly in many ways. He brought out, I mean, he loses his religious faith, not something which he mentions very much when he's Prime Minister of Northern Ireland in 1960s, but he completely loses his religious belief because of what he saw during the war. So his opening of the letter, he arrives with Byng at the end of August. Byng is brought out as one of the new generals to command 9th Corps, an exact previous general. I've arrived, at last arrived in this godforsaken place where a new landing was made. We were sailed all day and there's no room back, which is rather upsetting to one's nerves. That's one of the points, because it's such a narrow ground, you can't actually withdraw anywhere. There's nowhere to go, there's no rear area. You're actually permanently on the front line. Thank goodness they haven't got as much in the way of guns as the Bosch, but it's bad enough what they have. One landed just outside our mess when we're having tea and perforated my washing, otherwise no damage done. It is absolutely different from France. There is nothing here. We wash in salt water and collect fresh water for a weekly bath when our clothes is washed as well. We are all absolutely cut off and live in caves. Now, I've made the point about the staff, and the staff always get abused if they're in the rear end, they don't know what's going on. Certainly not the case in Gallipoli. The staff are actually in, and they are rewarded because they're there. They are not in the shadow because there aren't any shadows. They're there, they're lying, they're living in caves as well, and they are going through the same stuff as the men. Another point he makes is, he says, the old Turk is a great gentleman. He never shoots at the hospital ships in the bay or at the hospitals. Very different from our friend the Bosch. And as an interesting point, the British do get this respect for the Turks by the end of the war. They do respect them as fighting men, and they do respect the fact that they, by and large, fought fair. They didn't attack hospitals. They respected the Red Cross. Now, the Germans did as well. I mean, he's channeling a lot of propaganda, but the Germans there, I would suspect, as well. But there is this respect for the Turks. The Turks do fight clean, and that they do fight well, and that does come across. He then talks 10th September, back again on the peninsula, having a slight go of dysentery, but I'm absolutely recovered. The worst of it makes me sound weak. Everybody hears me getting the Gallipoli gallop. Now, you do get that mentioned that this is dysentery. It starts with diarrhea, but turns into dysentery. And it is quite a serious condition because it's completely debilitating. And I think when you look at the casualty figures for the campaign, it's something like over 200,000, but the majority of those are sick, and it is dysentery. By the way, it's just a disease from bad water, polluted water and food, and that is knocking people out, and that's where a lot of the casualties come from. So you mentioned everybody getting this and how very bad he was. As people think, oh, it's just a bunch of diarrhea 2 or 3 days, it is very, very debilitating disease. So he's got that. In fact, he ended up going back to Egypt for a couple of weeks. But then he describes, they're still there in the winter, this is now November 1915. We're having an awful time here. The wind is very high with sleet and torrents of rain everywhere. Everything leaks. I'm so cold I can hardly write. We have lost about a dozen men drowned in the trenches. It's a great deal worse than France, as the men can't get away anywhere and get clean clothes, but simply remain soaked. You can't imagine how bloody it is. However, we are all quite cheery and well. If humanity wants to go mad and fight, they will just have to put up with this sort of thing. And you see the cynicism coming through here, the sort of sarcasm. I must say, I've never been fitter in my life than I am now. I generally do a long walk every afternoon, and one does not eat too much. I'm always in bed by 7:30, unless there's something. I'm called up generally twice a night with wires, which is unpleasant in training. I suppose it is bound to end someday. So this is a staff officer, so he hasn't got a clue what's going on. We're stuck in the middle of this godforsaken hole. It's raining, he's freezing cold, and not even general seems to know why they're there or where they're there. This is because they were still making up their mind about the evacuation at this stage, as far as I know. And he says, it is snowing as I write, and I'm sitting in front of a stove made of an old oil drum. So that's the sort of conditions they're like by November. Freezing cold, sitting there, everybody knew they had failed, nobody knew what was going to happen next. And then his final letter is the 21st of December. And he says, you will know by now that we've evacuated Suva. It was the greatest success we have had, in my opinion. And that, you know, is probably the opinion of most historians, that the evacuation was the best bit of it. We had one man wounded, and we lost neither cart, wagon, nor gun. And he goes on to talk about it. Everybody expected a disaster when they were struggling difficulties. The beaches could have been shelled at any minute for the Turks if they sent a patrol over and seen their line was not held. Of course, all supplies were sent off previously. There's no great danger in that, but on Sunday we had only a thin line and very few guns. But not that many, but enough. It would be a disaster if the Turks had attacked and actually captured these men, but you know, there wasn't enough to actually fight them off. He talks about Turkish airplanes coming over and they thought they'd actually spotted what was happening, but they hadn't, and it appears that they didn't spot. And then there's bad weather as well, and it was quite lucky that they got a clear patch of weather to actually get people off. Perhaps a description of the last night would interest you. We were there for the last few days in a sloop where we dined. We went ashore with the last of the big guns were being loaded up. At 7:30 the first troops came down, and it was so well organised that each regiment was reported by its numbers as they went past different points in the road, so that we knew exactly where each unit was and when it was likely to arrive. We all had an officer, went to the beach and simply walked straight onto lighters, each lighter being pulled off when it was full. No odds and ends, no strays, and in the meantime the patrols had reported the Turks were hard at work in their own trenches. 4:50 really ticketish time came because it was the end of the day, the front line was evacuated, so at that stage they actually had to move the last troops out of the front line, so everybody was that stage was actually moving back, and this was the key bit. The only hits is when the report of 15 men had gone missing, but as he says, the fact that they noticed 15 men had gone missing in the middle of an evacuation of that steel does show you how well things were going. 15 men turned up. I think the final stage was the most dramatic and the one that impressed me considerably. When all the men were reported in, the general and I walked to the supply dump, which was kept in case of bad weather, to see if everything was ready for burning. There was not a soul between him, that's General, the General Commanding, and the Turks, the Turkish army. We went on down to our boat and the pile was lit. It was a fine sight. This was burning all the supplies they couldn't take off. And it was with a sensation of relief and the feeling of leaving a place we'd more or less our home for 6 months, which dramatic circumstances were extraordinary. And we sailed the same morning in daylight. And he mentioned the Turks continued firing for some time. The Turks didn't realise for about a day or two what happened. Yeah. So it was a very, very successful operation that they did with the whole lot out. Now, the point in reading that, you know, Bruce is saying that he and the general were the last men off the beach. Somebody else claimed to be the last man off the beach in Silva, and that was a major claim on that leg. future Prime Minister. He also was one of the last men off the beach. So it's an interesting thought on that final night. You have two future Prime Ministers standing on that beach. Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, Clement Attlee, and the Prime Minister of Northern Ireland, Basil Good. So did they, when they met, as they must have done after the Second World War, did they ever chat about this? They were reminiscing about that night and silver up on that nice silver beach. And it's an interesting point that politicians of that generation, you need to put that in mind, they did share this, they had the shared experience of the First World War. So those politicians, British German, had that, British and people from Northern Ireland did have this shared experience of the First World War, even up on top of the other politicians. So Brooke's letters are a very interesting source. I think they tell you something about Brooke himself as Prime Minister and the combination of his personality. You see his cynicism, detachment coming through about this. He knew it was a shambles. He was on the staff. He could see what was going on. So, and it's a quality he brings, I think, to being Prime Minister to a certain extent as well. So I'll just leave you with us, those few accounts. There are many more stories here. The guide is there to be used. We would like, you know, we want the search to continue. We won't want to say the centenary is over. The history is written and we move on. There's much more to be said. There's a lot of stories that haven't come out yet. And there's a very interesting, got a bit of stuff in this office and that's more of that. So I'll just close it on that note.